This is a Media Lab podcast. Welcome to Putting It Together, the podcast that goes through the entire body of work of Stephen Sondheim, show by show and song by song. My name is Kyle Marshall, your self-described Sondheim expert. Well, we are now here at the end of our Pacific Overtures season, at least somewhat. We have a few more episodes to deconstruct some of the cut songs, as well as to look at some of the recordings of this show, plus a little bonus episode that I have planned here as well. But for the individual songs that are in this score, we are at the end. To delve into the song, I invited back on Erik Stadnik to really pull apart what the lyrics are saying, what the music is doing inside of this song, and how we as an audience are supposed to read what is happening on stage in front of us. So I'm very excited to jump into that, and we might as well just do that right now. Screams are blowing, she was coming. Winds are blowing, she was coming, she was going. Roads are turning, journey with them. Erik Stadnik, thank you so much for joining me here again.
Thank you so much for having me back, Kyle. This is an honor and a thrill to be back for my fourth appearance.
Is it fourth?
I think. Yeah.
You're so close to that smoking jacket for the Five Timers Club.
Well, if I remember, you ended up splitting the Eating Primrose.
Yes.
Didn't you end up splitting that into two episodes?
Into two episodes, yes.
So four recordings, five episodes.
Oh, I see. Okay, great. Well, then your smoking jacket is in the mail.
Fantastic.
Well, thank you so much for coming back. Pacific Overtures has been a really fascinating season for me. I would definitely put this as being, at least a few months ago, one of those shows that I didn't really have a huge knowledge about, other than Someone in the Tree, Chrysanthemum Tea, like those songs that kind of get sung in a bunch of revivals and cabaret shows. I would love to know what your history is.
I mean, I think it's similar to pretty much what every guest this season has said, and to yours as well. It's, you know, when I first started getting into Sondheim, it was via whatever was available on DVD and things and cast albums, but DVD especially, because I like seeing shows if I can at all possible. Like, there's the Sondheim at Carnegie Hall from like 91 or something that had the big sort of benefit. And they show a poster for Pacific Overtures. There are no songs for Pacific Overtures in the benefit.
Right.
And I kind of, from that, I was like, maybe it's not good. I don't know. And so I kind of just didn't go to it. And then eventually there was a Sondheim review being done by a theater near me when I used to live in Washington, D.C., Signature Theater there, which was sort of like a Sondheim hotbed,
yes,
if you will. And they did a Sondheim review that had both Someone in a Tree and Poems in it. Mm. And both of those songs, in completely different ways, just devastated me. And I thought, well, clearly I'm an idiot and Pacific Overtures is a work of genius and I need to rectify it.
Yeah.
And then I was able to by going and finding both the cast album and the original and the revival cast album, but also the super grainy, questionable legality version that's on YouTube that was TV broadcast, I think, from 76. Mm-hmm. And watching it, I was astonished at how incredible the score was, how monumental the achievement was, and what a bonkers idea it was to, hey, let's put this on Broadway. Because it's there's nothing about it that's commercial in any way, shape, or form. It is an experimental theater piece in almost every way.
Oh, yeah. In many ways. There's this other podcast I listen to for movies called Blank Check. And
I love Blank Check. It's a great show.
I love Blank Check too. But the whole idea, right? There's these directors who get this huge success sometime in their career. And then they're kind of given a series of blank checks to be like, yeah, make whatever you want. This is so much the Hal Prince, Stephen Sondheim blank check.
100%.
No other person would have been able to release this onto a Broadway stage in 1976.
No, not even close. And there's a really great, I think Broadway Masterworks is the name of the video series. Short little YouTube video clips of interviews with various Broadway figures. And there's one with Hal Prince about Pacific Overtures. And he just flat out says, he's like, we thought it was interesting. We had to convince everybody, hey, we're going to do this. And it ended up being this wonderful thing we love. And it didn't make a dime and I couldn't care less.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Exactly.
It was just like, okay, that's Hal Prince. He can do what he wants. He's made enough money. And Sondheim again was sort of like, he'd already had three fairly successful shows right in a row, back to back to back. It was, their chance to do something just unexpected and very idiosyncratic.
To try and wrangle this as much as possible, this being kind of like the final episode of the individual songs we're going to be talking about, I don't know, where do you fall then? Like, is this top Sondheim, middle Sondheim? Like, where do you rate this in, like, his oeuvre?
See, I personally actually think it's top tier Sondheim, but I am also someone who will cry at the prospect of the power of history.
Sure.
Like someone in a tree, I cry at someone in a tree, which is not an emotional song per se, but the idea that we are all witnesses to history passing us by. Like, I'm getting chills just thinking about it. That's the kind of person I am. So Pacific Overtures, because of its subject nature and because of how it approaches those topics, really pushes past sort of, as much as I love shows like Company and Follies and stuff, they're about human relationship drama, which is interesting and always worth revisiting. But this is up there with, like, Into the Woods with me for being, like, and Sunday in the Park with George. It's about, like, big ideas. It's a very concept-y show about big ideas.
Yeah, it is. Well, that's, I think, where I struggle with this show a little bit. Now, having done the deep dive for all of the songs, like, there are individual pieces in this that are among my absolute favorites that Sondheim has ever written. And there are songs that I get actually really emotional to the more that I listen to them. Like Someone in the Tree is a good example of that. I had a great conversation with Tom Sesma about that, about, like, there is this deep emotion that's in there. I do get emotional over, like, poems. And at the same time, like, as a theater piece, which is the hardest thing I think for even modern audiences, is like, yeah, there are characters, but they're not really the point of Pacific Overtures. Like, it really is this, like, big heady idea of, like, how do we interact with history, how do we contend with, like, passages of time, etc., etc. So it's I understand why this is one of the least revived shows of Sondheim, even though there is a deep love for it by many people.
Early on during the endless pandemic, some friends in America and I, we were kind of doing, like, weekly viewings of, like, things we'd find on YouTube. And I'm in Prague, so I'm, you know, 6 hours ahead, but we would find a time where it wasn't too late for me and it wasn't too early for them. And we were all, like, working from home at that point. No one expected productivity, so it was fine. And one week we watched the Sam Mendes directed Company, which you can find and is
That's the Donmar Warehouse version.
Yeah. It's interesting. And then I was like, have y'all seen Pacific Overtures? And my friends were all like, oh no. And I that was the suggestion. I made them watch it. And they're like, well, this is a thing. And they were all sort of, there were three of them and they were all both floored by its beauty and its power, but also just baffled by its, like, very existence. And were really confused as to what they were meant to feel or think or care about. And I think, I know you were talking in one of the other episodes, Act Two, you really do get sort of very lost in, like, what's going on now? What am I watching? What is happening? Like, it starts off so strong with Please Hello, and then it feels like you kind of get lost in the weeds a bit. Especially when you have a song like A Bowler Hat, which is kind of the entire show in microcosm. And you're like, well, what more needs to be said? Two more songs. One of which is one of the most beautiful songs Sondheim has ever written, but is essentially a threat of sexual assault, which is charming.
Technically, that episode has not been released as we're recording this, but it's the prettiest creepy song I've ever listened to.
Yes, 100%. And then you have Next, which is the first thing in the show that is forward facing as opposed to backward looking. And I like the fact that you do have that sort of the bookend of Next, but it is kind of a different thing. It's like, it's almost like a piece of a different show. The music's different. They change the costumes. They change the style. They change, you know, they bring on female singers. There's drums suddenly. Like, it feels like it was airlifted in from modern society instead of trying to somehow replicate 19th century Japan.
I think that's a good point. Yeah, this is where the show really changes that looking back to looking forward. I also forgot to prep you for this, but I'm going to kind of throw you under the bus. What is happening in the show, like, right before this song starts?
If I remember correctly, what is happening in the show is there's been sort of a significant amount of infighting. One of our two leads has been killed by the other for sort of being too accommodating of the West. And essentially there's been, and then Pretty Lady ties into that as well, this sort of strong, violent pushback against these, essentially these imperialist capitalists, whatever you want to call them, coming in. And the essentially the emperor, who up to this point had literally been a puppet, and the show, right, a literal puppet and a figurative puppet, decides to speak for himself for the first time. And in a fantastic coup de théâtre that I didn't know was coming the first time I watched the production, I was like, oh, it's the reciter all along, you know, a great little reveal. And suddenly we flash forward to a very different sort of model of Japan. And we essentially accelerate through the sort of Meiji period, which took Japan from feudal era to modern society in about 30 years, which seems unthinkable. But yeah, it's sort of just rising tension, violence, people getting killed, and sort of resistance until the emperor decides, nope, we're going to go with it because we're going to die otherwise, I think is his thinking, probably.
You're correct. This is what the emperor says. Mm-hmm. I have the script in front of me, so this is not just off the top of my head. This is what the emperor says. The day when others speak for me is past. From now on, my word shall be law, and mine alone. I am the Emperor Meiji. Rise and listen. No more will we draw sword, one Japanese against another. Those who have committed murder in my name have been misguided. In the future, they will be restrained, along with those who have encouraged them. Rise. From this day forth, all samurai will put aside their swords and cease to wear their crested robes. They will take up useful trades. In the name of progress, we will turn our backs on ancient ways. We will cast aside our feudal forms, eliminate all obstacles which hinder our development. We will organize an army and a navy equipped with the most modern weapons, and when the time is right, we will send forth expeditions to visit with our less enlightened neighbors. We will open up Formosa, Korea, Manchuria, and China. We will do for the rest of Asia what America has done for us.
Horrifying. That final line, we will do for the rest of Asia what America has done for us.
I really want to key in on that line because I think it is so fascinating. I don't pretend to know what the culture, I guess, knew about Japan in 1976 when this premiered, or how they were contending with, like, America's role in imperialism. But yeah, for me, that sounds like such a threat, right? And if you dig in a little bit about, like, Japan's role in the rest of Asia and how they really were tyrants of that area for so long, like, they saying, like, we see what America has done, and we're not trying to combine something so we can attack them. We're going to use that so that we can use what they use against us against other people. Mm-hmm. And that feels like, oh, that's a very interesting approach.
Yeah, the sort of moment when the emperor sort of strips himself of his little his robes and is wearing this very sort of Western looking, you know, general's suit kind of thing with all these ribbons. Like, what did you do? There's no war. What is that? And it's clear that the emperor, who didn't get the name Meiji until he died after, it's sort of, that's a weird way, the emperor.
But
Emperor Meiji, that he has decided, at least in the show, in history it's unclear who decided, but in the show, he's decided, we cannot beat the West, but we can emulate the West and dominate our sort of sphere of influence. And so you have, yeah, exactly as he says, Korea, China, Manchuria, and they all, in one way or another, fall under the sway of the Japanese Empire. I mean, there's even the, you know, war with Russia in, like, shortly after 1900. So, like, massive expansionist tendencies modeling itself explicitly on the Western powers.
Yeah, and so that's what really leads into this song. I think that that's why this song, I keep using this word, is like where I struggle with, is like, what is the ultimate message that we're supposed to take from this? Is this an evolvement of this basically veiled threat that the emperor has just given, or is it something a little bit different? So sorry for breaking into the episode, but there are some people and organizations that I need to thank that help this show continue to go. I always start off these sections by telling you that if you'd like to help support the show for absolutely free, there is a way for you to do that. You can give a rating and review on whatever app you listen to podcasts in. It's very much appreciated. And if you'd like to help monetarily, which will only help to grow and make this show better, you can do so over at our Patreon page. Please do not donate if it impacts you negatively financially. By the way, this week we have two new patrons. So thank you so much, David and Jay. But I also need to give a huge thank you to the God That's Good tier from Patreon, the triumphant quartet of Jack, Todd, Carrie, and Witty. Putting Together is also a proud member of the Alberta Podcast Network, locally grown, community supported. The Alberta Podcast Network promotes and supports Alberta-made podcasts and connects their audiences with Alberta-based businesses and organizations. This week, we are brought to you by ATB Cares. With ATB Cares, giving is easy. Donate through ATB Cares and ATB will match 20% of every dollar donated to eligible Albertan charities, maximizing the impact of your donation. Visit atbcares.com to choose your cause and donate today. This week, we're also brought to you by the Alberta Podcast Network, so let's go and listen to one of our other great shows. Hi, my name is Kyle.
I'm Dave.
And I'm The Machine.
And we do a podcast called Kyle and Dave versus The Machine. It's a podcast where a sentient machine is forcing us to watch movies in order to prevent it from initiating the apocalypse. Although, Dave, you and I tend to talk about the ideas of the movie rather than the movie itself.
Well, it's the machine's fault, like everything, and then by effect your fault, Kyle, that you've invited me, and this is the only thing I like to talk about.
I mean, I'm not going to face the apocalypse alone, so you seem like a good patsy to bring along with me.
If you wanted somebody that was going to give you some hope, you picked the wrong person.
Kyle and Dave vs. The Machine is a proud member of the Alberta Podcast Network, locally grown, community supported. New episodes are out every Friday. This is how the song Next starts. So the chorus comes on stage and sings, "Streams are flowing, see what's coming, next. Winds are blowing, see what's coming, see what's going, next. Roads are turning, journey with them, a little learning, next. Water's churning, lightning flashes, kings are burning, sift the ashes, next.
Streams are flowing. See what's coming next.
We will build railroads, foundries, telegraphs, and steamships.
Winds are blowing. See what's coming. See what's going next.
Factories will spring up all across our land.
Roads are turning. Journey with them. A little learning next.
Foreign architects will reconstruct our cities.
Water turning. Lightning flashes. Kings are burning. Sift the ashes.
Western powers will one day recognize us as...
I listened to your excellent episode about the advantages of floating in the middle of the sea.
Right.
And this is so clearly directly bookending that we have...
Yes.
The repeated use of the present progressive or the present continuous with dreams are flowing, see what's coming. Right down to the kings are burning.
Kings are burning, right, yeah.
Yeah, which... But instead of kings are burning somewhere not here, we have kings are burning, sift the ashes.
Yeah, find the stuff you can get out of
find
it.
Find whatever good stuff you can find in this burnt king and move on. And it's such a different approach using language that is superficially very similar. But mm-hmm. here, all of the ing verbs have a very sort of now, movement, go, go, go. Whereas right. there it was, the sifting of the rice, the painting of the screens, the sort of harmonious yeah. sort of, it stressed the continuity, and here it stresses the action.
That sift the ashes definitely calls to itself. Also, reflecting a similar lyric in the in Into the Woods, sift through the ashes.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah. he comes back sift to that a little bit. But in this one, I think it's a little bit different context here, for sure. I also like to like just the way that this song is presented. Like it's almost like this very they start low and they're singing and they kind of crescendo mm-hmm. up into being a little bit more forceful and stuff like that. So
Yeah, it's like a machine almost. It's sort of like it starts with this slow hum and sort of rumbles higher and higher.
Yeah, it gets higher and higher. That, like, that march of progress is like emulated through the way that they're actually singing. It continues on by going, tower tumbles, tower rises. Next, tower crumbles, man revises, motor rumbles, civilizes, more surprises. Next. Now, the next stanza is not in the Finishing the Hat book, although it's in both versions of the musical. So let me go down. It actually goes then, learn the lesson from the master, add the sugar, spread the plaster, do it nicer, do it faster. Next.
Tower tumbles, tower rises. Next. Tower tumbles, man rises. Motor rumbles, civilizes. More surprises. Next. Learn the lesson from the master, add the sugar, spread the plaster, do it nicer, do it faster. Next.
The practical bird.
Is that not in the book?
It's not in the book. No,
that's a weird ass typo. That is what that is, because that
I know, like, this
is very much part of the song.
Yeah, absolutely. So that's, I think, just an oversight from that one. But let's talk about that for a little bit here. For me, I just want to call it just some great rhyming that is happening here, going with tower rises, then man revises, civilizes, like just that, like recurring,
and then recurring, more surprises. Even he does a quadruple rhyme.
Yeah, that's right. Master plaster faster in the next one, but
yeah, I mean, he's just throwing rhymes here left and right. He's just throwing fireballs. So to get to this idea of how he's supposed to read this song, which I think is something, it is very tricky, and because it's the final song, it sort of affects how you think about the entire show. You know, civilizes. We have it right there. They're saying civilizes, as if we're meant to think that the Japan we saw at the beginning of the show wasn't civilized. But in fact, if anything, it was exceptionally civilized and had rules and routine for everything, right? And so clearly, if you're paying attention, already you're like, oh, wait, this view of progress is undermining the value of other types of civilization and saying the only true civilization is Western, you know, capitalist, constantly improving, consumer-driven.
Absolutely. And I think the biggest tip of the hat is in that second stanza that's not included in the book, which is the idea of, like, do it nicer, do it faster.
Mm.
And I think that that is such an interesting way to phrase that idea. It's like, we have to catch up with what we feel we are being left behind in right now.
Mm-hmm.
But we also need to do it in a way that appears like we are being, like, deferential and stuff to people. So there's this, like, I don't know, cunning to this that is also the subtext to this idea.
I also love that we have callbacks to previous songs. So we have Add the Sugar, which, if you don't know the show, is like, well, what are they adding sugar to? They're adding sugar to tea.
Right.
They did not do until the British taught them. And we saw the British introduce sort of British style tea in Please Hello.
Yes.
And then we had you add the milk before the tea in a bowler hat. So it sort of completes this.
That's right.
This sort of progression of tea usage. Same with plaster. We had the sort of adjustment in Act 2 from sort of Japanese-style architecture to, you know, we're having European architects build plastered homes. I think the key line here is learn the lesson from the master. Like, that's it's what the song is about.
And so in this case, America is the master.
America is the master along with Britain and the other powers. Mm-hmm. Britain really gets a lot of stick, actually, in this section of the show, which is funny. And so if you do come away from Next thinking, oh, my God, they're terrifying. What are they doing? Learn the lesson from the master. They learned it from us. It's like that old drug commercial. I learned it by watching you, Dad. It's very much this song deliberately saying, screaming in your face, if you find our rise terrifying, you only have yourself to blame, and we're just mirroring you.
Yeah, in a way, it's interesting you bring that up. In a way, what I've been thinking about in this week that we're recording as the United States is pulling out of Afghanistan and the whole, like, war on terror seems to being admitted to have been a bust here, is I can recall 20 plus years ago when the idea was, like, we're spreading democracy around the world.
Yes.
We're allowing people to grab democracy.
Nation building.
Nation building. And I think this is the interesting part, is that at least within the context of the song, they're saying, yes, like, give this to us. We're going to grab a hold of this idea that you're giving to us, but we're going to do it better. And we're going to do it faster than what you can do it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. It is them essentially saying, sure, we'll become what you want us to become. Mm-hmm. And we're going to do it great. And that's going to be awesome for everyone except you, maybe.
Right.
But maybe not even awesome for anybody. Maybe it's terrible for everyone, which I think is one reading of the song.
Going forward, they continue singing, streams are roaring, overspilling.
Sorry, I don't mean to interrupt. I just want to, Meiji has his little thing about the practical bird here.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I did. I wrote that down too. Thank you for reminding me. So yeah, right before the next bit of the song starts, Emperor Meiji says the following, I think supposed to emulate a haiku here. Mm. The practical bird, having no tree of its own, borrows another. Actually, let's just break that down here. I think it's just kind of an evolution of what we were just talking about. But again, simplified into like a very compact little statement.
And it is actually, I think it's the actual only haiku, maybe? It is 575, the practical bird.
Oh, yeah.
Having no tree.
Okay. Yeah, it does. Yeah, that is it's an actual.
It's an actual haiku. And he even said, I'm not writing real haikus. You know, we've had all this bird imagery throughout the show just consistently. And we've had these sort of aphorism type sort of the poems being inserted the haikus. And this is one where the music stops and the emperor just stands there and says, what did you expect us to do? We've kind of lost our way. We need to take somebody else's.
Yeah. And I think like in a way, it's actually been a while, a few weeks since I've watched the video that is on YouTube that you mentioned. I think, again, subtly what we're supposed to see here is like a real fast forwarding of the history of Japan, like from Meiji up until like present day sort of thing. Yeah. Like people are putting on like modern dress and stuff as this kind of goes along. And that gets to be extremely important here because this is how the next section goes. It goes, streams are roaring, overspilling, next. Old is boring, new is thrilling, keep exploring, next. First the thunder, just a murmur, a little blunder, next. Then the wonder, see how pretty, going under, what a pity, next.
Streams are roaring, overspilling, next. Old is boring, new is thrilling, keep exploring, next. First the thunder, just a murmur, a little blunder, next. Then the wonder, see how pretty, going under, what a pity.
It depends on what recording you're listening to, but I do want to call it the 2004 revival, because at this point in the song, there is a very obvious atomic blast that happens in the background before the song kind of picks up here again.
Yes.
And I don't think that's, again, by mistake, obviously, but I think this is really mentioning, like, they're going, World War II happens, the atomic bombs are dropped on Japan. And then they have to try and pick up the pieces and keep going forward to the next thing.
Yeah, it is really interesting that in the 75 original production, they do sort of do this sort of fast forward. And then they obviously mention the militarism and things, but they don't focus on it in any way.
Right.
And what you end up is getting the very much post-war Japan of Seiko Watch and Sony and those sort of like the big corporations, the sort of technology Japan. And that's kind of what you're left with at the end of the show. The revival does both. It sort of builds up, and then we have the militaristic Japan, and then the bomb, and then it's going to build up again and do the business Japan. Almost as if in that version, like, okay, it adapted once, that didn't work, and it's going to do it all over again, also in a very rapid short of period of time, where between, you know, it was only 30 years since the bomb dropped that Pacific Overtures was written.
Well, yeah, that's the interesting part about this. It's almost, I think, a little weird that they don't do something with that in the original production. I mean, other pieces of media had already done it. I always, like, Godzilla, of all things, is like 9 years after the atomic atomic bomb is dropped, and they're very clearly discussing
it's
that
about
in that film.
Yeah. I think the line, the never mind a small disaster line that's coming up, I think that's the only clear reference. And it may have been they just decided it would have been maybe a bit in poor taste in the middle of a musical to suddenly be like,
yeah.
Because the thing about I haven't seen the entire revival, but that clip of Next is on YouTube and I've watched it a billion times. It is kind of jarring to be in the middle of this song and then like, and then the atom bomb comes and it's
true enough. Yeah. I guess where I come down to is that if you were doing, I guess, a similar piece about like the history of Germany, it'd be like, and then some stuff happened in the 30s and 40s. Yeah. Anyways, on to the next thing. It's like, well, let's talk a bit about what's going on.
I think that's fair. It's fair. Yeah. I just, one thing we haven't mentioned yet is that by this point, the women are on stage, at least in original production.
Oh, right.
Other productions have handled that differently. Some have had women on stage the whole time, blah, blah, blah. But in this version, they've come on by now, which I think is meant to be a clear sign of good, that it is meant to be progress.
Yes.
That there's actual women on stage singing in their real voice. Like, that's meant to be a good thing and a sign of the good things that modernity can bring. And then the other thing we haven't talked about yet is simply next, which is this tremendously powerful word in English that Sondheim writes about himself in Finishing the Hat. It's like,
he does.
How great is this sort of Anglo-Saxon harsh next, next, next?
That's what he says. It's like, he writes specifically, like, lyric writing would be so much easier in Italian because literally you have so many words that rhyme with each other. But it's like, what is brilliant about the English language is that next is such a strong word to sing. Like, it's a one syllable word and it's a very hard consonant at the end that just does not have the same weight if it's like, what does he write? Successivo or Volgendid or Suivant or something like that.
Yeah, Suivant, yeah. Suivant. Doesn't have the same joie de vivre as Suivant. Yeah, it's harsh and aggressive. Next. Next.
Yeah.
Next.
Yeah. His last sentence he writes is like, how lucky to have an explosive word like next, which sums up the violence of the intrusion sonically and contrasts with the gentle mellifluousness of translated haiku so vividly. Then again, English has always been the language whose sound I like best, except for Russian. which I love that he puts that in.
What a weird dude.
He probably was pitching very heavily for more of that Russian ambassador. We need more of this character in the show.
Oh, well, certainly. I mean, he does kind of steal the show for about 2 minutes, yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's just, he's sort of, it's sort of, you know, similar rhyme scheme or same rhyme scheme, but he keeps adapting and sort of adding new sort of little tweaks. But it keeps getting on this idea again and again that the song is, I won't say it's repetitive because it's not his style, but it is very consistent within itself about being about the sort of constant ongoing march of progress. There is no end. There is no goal to be achieved. The goal is to just keep moving and always moving. And no matter what happens, you keep moving forward.
Well, I think we were mentioning here before as well, like how much this is tied to other ideas and other songs throughout the show. Mm-hmm. Like, what an interesting evolution from Someone in a Tree, right? Like, there's only cups of tea and history and Someone in a Tree. Mm-hmm. And this is kind of an evolution of that. It's like, history marches forward. You are a small part of it and Someone in a Tree. That's kind of one of the messages from that song. Mm-hmm. And here it's like, we keep going. Like, what is happening now doesn't matter. It's we keep going and going and going.
And your part in it is essentially irrelevant because, you know, as we saw, kings are burning, sift to the ashes. You know, tower crumbles. Oh, well, what a pity. Just
build a new tower.
Build a new tower. Who cares? Keep going.
So they continue on singing, streams are flying, use the motion. Next, streams are drying, mix a potion. Streams are dying, try the ocean. Brilliant notion, next. Never mind the small disaster. Who's the stronger? Who's the faster? Let the pupil show the master. Next, next.
Streams are flying, use the potion. Next. Streams are drying, mix the potion. Streams are dying, try the ocean. Brilliant notion, next. Never mind the small disaster. Who's the stronger? Who's the faster? Let the pupil show the master. Next.
There are 223.
So I think this is where it kind of tips over again. It's like, we were talking about in that previous lyric where it's do it nicer, do it faster, like learn a lesson from the master, but do it nicer, do it faster. Now we're getting to the fact it's like, no, let the pupil show the master how it's done. We are going to eclipse the master now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. By just being completely indifferent to everything. Because this is actually a lyric I misheard for the longest time until I looked it up. Streams are drying, mix a potion. Okay. Streams are dying. Well, try the ocean. Ah, brilliant notion. Next.
We've
destroyed our environment. What about the ocean? It's still there. Great. Let's do it. Let's destroy that too.
The world is just a series of resources we can extract from until it eventually dies.
Yeah. But I mean, that was and is and still in some sectors, that was the view for most of the 20th century. It was The yep. world was just full of things waiting for us to use them, and whatever. You know, damn the consequences, kind of.
That'll be a future problem. Let the people in 2021 worry about that.
Future Bleef's problem. Yeah, exactly. That's a different situation.
This is the part of the song, then there's a lot of statements that are said. Like, individual characters come up and basically just state out these certain facts. Mm-hmm. Now, they're very different between the original Broadway cast and the revival. None of them are written in the book, so I had to do some transcription here this morning. So apologies if I don't get these, like, 100% right, but the few things that in the original Broadway cast are said are, there are 223 Japan airline offices taking up 153 cities throughout the world. There are 8 Toyota dealerships in the city of Detroit. The Enzego watch is the 3rd best-selling watch in Switzerland. 57% of the bicentennial souvenirs sold in Washington, D.C. in 1975 were made in Japan. Japan exports a ton of monosodium glutamate, and then has a bunch of figures after that. About
a bunch of chemicals.
Monosodium glutamate. In 1978, the beaches will be reopened for public bathing. And in 1975, there were 179 days where the air in Tokyo was acceptable. Before we go to, like, the different statements, do these statements work for you? Like, is there anything that you feel like these
this
need to be
this group
there for?
Does, and it's the only group that does.
Okay.
And let me tell you why. So I like the fact that, first off, it's Japan airline ticket offices, because the whole show had been about Japanese isolationism.
Right.
And so the first thing is, now there are Japan airline ticket offices in 150 countries around the world. Like, Japan is completely connected.
Plenty of people come and go.
This massive global network. Great. 8 trade dealerships, city of Detroit. Seiko is the 3rd best-selling watch in Switzerland. The car one is fine. Like, I think it's funny. The watch one, though, is quite interesting. Because we had in a bowler hat, it's called a pocket watch, and this idea of the introduction of timekeeping and the progress that timekeeping represents. Because earlier in the show, we had, you know, day of the rat, day of the rabbit.
Right.
And now suddenly we're doing proper timekeeping. And so it's very nice to see that Seiko is coming up. Of course, the irony of the bicentennial souvenirs being made in Japan is just too beautiful not to mention, I think. It also gets a laugh from the audience, which I think is quite funny. Then the one about, you know, all these chemicals we make. And that's when you start to go, wait, is that good? Are we happy with that?
Right.
And then the last two are about the fact that Japan has destroyed its environment.
Right. Yeah.
It's that, you know, by 1978, so in a few years, some of the beaches will be reopened for public bathing. And then the Weather Bureau says, about half the days of the year, the air quality was acceptable.
You can actually breathe.
You can actually breathe the air about half the time in Tokyo. Really? And so you realize that it's not just like, hey, look, all Japan's done. It's look what has happened to Japan in the name of this progress, in the name of progress, as Meiji says, what they have done to their lands, to their ocean, to their air, in the name of matching America. And then you look, because it's all reflexive, you look, what have we done to our land and our air and the ocean in the name of our progress?
I think that's super insightful. I actually hadn't pieced that together, but you're right. It's all thematically relevant, all these things that are being brought up. Like, other songs have talked about this, or other moments within the show have talked about this. Like, in the revival, after that very obvious atomic blast, they actually redo basically from, what is it, Streams Are Roaring. First the Thunder or something, I think, is where
somewhere,
they go back
somewhere to. Somewhere in there, they sort of reset.
They reset, come back, and then they have these people come out and they say, in 1991, Japanese investors bought the Empire State Building. The best-selling car in Detroit is the Toyota Camry. G.I. Joe, the all-American action hero, is entirely manufactured in Japan. The top hitter on the New York Yankees last season was Atoi Matsui. Sony is now the number one brand in America. Last spring, Japanese self-defense forces joined the American allies to help reconstruct Iraq. But you're right. These are facts for sure. But you're right. I don't know how much those are actually relevant to the rest of the show.
No, I agree. And there was some talk, I forget which episode now, I apologize to your guest host who came on, talking about Yellow Peril, this idea that we should fear the East, we should fear Japan, we should fear China. Those quotes feed more into Yellow Peril-y territory for me. Like, oh, the Empire State Building, oh, that's bought by Japanese. Oh, God, what are we going to do? It's like, it's a building. It was bought by some investors. Does it really matter who owns it? And, or like, why does it matter that the Yankees has a prominent Japan? Like, why? I guess it's interesting that Japan has sort of become really good at baseball, but you couldn't say that about like football because Japan hasn't gotten into football at all.
Right.
So it's not as if Japan is like conquering all sports. They like baseball. It's popular there. Well, that's
baseball
okay.
is the America sport.
I think that's the thing. It's the American pastime.
I heard that Japan is also baking apple pies. I don't want to alarm anyone. But.
And no one else has ever done that. Don't tell the French. I don't think personally that the ones in the revival or the ones in the London cast, which are also slightly different, I don't think they have the same resonance as the originals. And none of them are negative also. Whereas original cast has these two at the end that are clearly negative statements about the current state of Japan.
And about Japan, right? They're being a little bit critical of that nation. That's interesting. Yeah, I agree. So get better, book writers who are adapting this coming up. The reciter actually does come at this point, who's also Meiji as well. But he goes, Nippon, the floating kingdom. There was a time when foreigners were not welcome here, but that was long ago. 130 years. Welcome to Japan. And then the chorus finishes off, brilliant notions, still improving. Make the motions, keep it moving. Next, 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 next.
Nippon! The floating kingdom. There was a time when foreigners were not welcome here. But that was long ago. 150 years. Welcome to Japan.
Next! Next! Brilliant notions, still improving. Next! Next! Make the motions, keep it moving.
Blackout.
Yeah.
Dun, 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 dun. The show
yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know how you get so much emotion into the line, welcome to Japan.
Oh my God. So I feel like there's an essay that someone could write about this because specifically, and I love BD Wong. Don't get me wrong. I like love BD Wong. However,
Mako, it's all Mako, baby.
Mako, how he says that line sounds like he has been through a fight. Like he's been defeated.
100%.
2.5 hours of show. It's like, welcome to Japan. Like he is done with it.
There was a time when foreigners were not welcome here, but that was long ago. 120 years. Welcome to Japan.
You know, and they have this wonderful, as we began, this sort of fisherman and his wife sort of in the traditional clothing sort of move slowly across stage. And so you have this image of what Nippon was when we saw it and what Japan is now. And well, this idea
Well, I was just going to say specifically again about that, like Nippon, how he starts this off again, the advantages of floating in the middle of the sea. Like when we start the show with Mako, he's like, Nippon, like he punctuates that. Like he is very forceful with that. And again, here he's just like, Nippon. he's tired. He's going through it. And then, it's so utterly defeated by the end.
Yeah. And so it is this very, you suddenly feel in a way that maybe you hadn't been or you'd been sort of struggling to articulate that, yes, modern Japan is wonderful in many ways and has given many wonderful things to the world and equality for women or something resembling closer equality for women is great and all these wonderful things and art and food and it's good that we're all interconnected now. That's nice, I think. But it's also everything that was lost. Just everything that was burned and destroyed and ruined in the name of creating this new thing. I think it's very interesting that in the original production, even the choreography is the same from the advantages of floating in the middle of the sea. Where they sort of form this triangle and they sort of step forward with their hands. It's almost identical, but here it's obviously a very, very different purpose. And Mako is just sort of standing, like, he's lost all of he's just in the black now. He's not wearing any costume. He's kind of standing there looking unhappy with everything.
I know.
They're singing, next, next. It is a wild way to end a show. But I there's no way to feel except ambivalent, I don't think.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I don't know how you can come away from this song and really feel, yay, everything's great, yay, Japan, or ultimately feel everything's terrible. It's obviously it's mixed.
Well, I think the biggest thing, I was talking to someone, boy, I record too many podcasts, and now I can't remember if it was on the podcast or I was just having a conversation with a person.
Yeah.
These are modern problems, people.
Very modern problems. But yeah.
The conversation I remember having was how Japan is actually pretty unique in this aspect, in that when you see, well, Canada especially, I think about this, right, where we try to have this Canadian identity, but we are so influenced by the United States.
51st state problem. It's sort of,
yeah,
how do you actually distinguish yourself from your southern neighbor who is the most powerful country in the world?
Exactly. And I think a lot of other nations have that same struggle with like Western approaches and infiltration and stuff like that. And so like Japan maybe not, isn't the only unique one out of this, but it is interesting how much they like open themselves up, trading with the West, becoming part of quote unquote like the modern economy, mm-hmm. but have still retained so much of what it means to be Japanese in many ways. But I do see like this struggle within the show and in the song with certain characters being like, we had like this old way of doing things, and we definitely force ourselves to modernize ourselves. We still want to retain our Japanese-ness of things while still being part of this culture. And what is the struggle to do that? And so from one point of view, yeah, for sure, it's like, ooh, what a downfall for this society. Mm-hmm. And on the other hand, I can see it being like, no, this is actually a good thing to you still retain a bit of yourselves, but be within modern society. So it's I don't know, it's a hard, this whole show is hard to like really wrestle with like all the things it's trying to communicate.
Yeah, it's funny, when I was preparing to come on the song, I was aside from Advantages of Floating in the Middle Sea, which is the bookend, but the non-Sondheim song that I was thinking of most is actually Let the Sunshine In from Hair, or the Closing of Hair, which if you don't know it, you know, they sing this whole song about the flesh failures, and then it becomes Let the Sunshine In, which everyone kind of knows. But it's this sort of, the way it is at the end of that show where, you know, our lead character has died in Vietnam, and for what? And the sort of, you know, the band, the people, the sort of tribe are singing at us to let the sunshine in. But it's not like cheerful. It's like, you people sitting in the audience right now are not being good. You are being bad people, and you're doing evil things because you refuse to acknowledge that we shall live in love and peace and harmony. And so this has a very similar feel to me where, you know, they're coming out and saying next, next, next. And it's about Japan, but it's 100% about America. It is 100% about what we have done and our responsibility and our failures as both a nation and like as a global power to be better and to not sacrifice things in the name of progress just because they're in the way. It's accusatory, I think. And so that makes it very, I don't know, it's unsettling.
Yeah. Another positive thing is that they don't come into the audience and force audience participation.
No, they don't. They stop doing that. People get very angry. Next is such a strange song in the context of the show, but I think it is a very good example of how Sondheim will do a closing number that sort of reframes and restates sort of what you've been seeing all evening, but also putting a twist on it that makes you wonder kind of what you've just watched.
You know, another thing I've been thinking about here this week as well is how different of a world we really truly live in, even from 2004. Mm-hmm. Like, when I was growing up, there was still this sense of, like, Japan, there's this other superpower, and they're like, they are, for lack of a better word, you know, infiltrating, like, Western businesses and becoming the best in all these organizations. I actually don't know how true that is anymore, because it seems
their economy collapsed, largely.
Well, there's that. Yeah. And it really is China that has kind of come in and being that Asian nation that people are either A, worried about, or B, trying to figure out how to contend with.
Mm-hmm.
Very different nations, you know, again, mm-hmm. democracy versus communism and all the other things that go into that. But to the extent, I don't know if I've mentioned this on the show before. So I grew up in this very small little town in Canada, and we actually had a twin city in Japan that we communicated with. So on my little town, and it always sounds like I'm making this place up, but I lived in a town called Rocky Mountain House. That's the actual name of it. And we were this sister town with Kamikawa in Hokkaido, Japan, and had teachers send over. Like, I learned Japanese for 2 years in high school.
Oh, wow.
So, like, there's those opportunities, and they came and showed us how to make sushi and all this other stuff. It was a really cool experience in this, literally, grew up in a town of 7,000 people. Like, it was small. A, no idea if that still is a thing that goes on. B, it's doubtful that we're doing the same thing with, like, China or other places here mm-hmm. nowadays. I am curious, like, the future of this show, while I think there's still relevance and looking at it even as, like, a historic piece in the, you know, history of musical theater, like, how relevant is it specifically that we're using Japan as the example nowadays? And I was struggling. I just don't think that it is. But I don't know if you have an alternate take on that.
I think in one way it's obviously, yeah, that at least for the time being, the sort of vague menace in the East has become China, which is not great that we sort of interchange the two when we think about it, but that's kind of how the news media reports on mm-hmm. this stuff. There always has to be some country out there that's coming to eat our lunch. That said, so that kind of means Pacific Overtures, the very idiosyncratic nature and the very Japanese sort of like thematic and dramaturgical elements throughout it maybe are less resonant. That said, the more specific you are in your art, weirdly conversely, the more universal it becomes. And so I think, you know, I've never had strong feelings about Japan. I grew up, you know, we're about the same age. I grew up in that sort of same like 80s, like go Japan sort of vibe. But it's not like I've ever personally thought much about Japan one way or the other, really. Yet this show made me feel personally guilty for having having done things as an American. And it made me think about, well, we colonized the Philippines, and we had the Philippines as a colony, and Cuba and Puerto Rico and all of these places, many of which have not yet gained their independence from us.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
And have not.
I mean, that's one of the biggest things, right? Puerto Rico having independence, becoming at least the 51st state, or at least whatever it happens
something. Instead of this weird Commonwealth thing where they get ignored whenever people want to ignore them, and left out to dry in a lot of ways, or the fact that we just sort of annexed Hawaii, and the Hawaiians did not want it to happen, and we said too bad, and now we just use it as like a vacation spot. It's awful. We have a massive history to contend with. And until all of that history has been rectified, I think Pacific Overtures will always be poignant and resonant in that way.
Yeah, I think that's a good point. I think some of those big, broader themes like the marching of time, colonialism, sadly always going to be relevant. And this show helps kind of shed a light on that. So overall, we talked about like your relationship with Pacific Overtures, but this song in particular, if you were to list like the songs of Pacific Overtures, where would this fall within that list of favorite to least favorite?
Probably in the middle somewhere. I think it's very effective at what it's doing, but it's actually, in a way, it's quite short and quite simple for Sondheim. It's fairly straightforward in its ambivalence. It's quite straightforward, I think. And it's not particularly beautiful. The music is very aggressive, and while it's fun, it's like very energetic. It's not. When you have a show that has poems, There Is No Other Way, Someone in a Tree, Pretty Lady, like, you have beautiful, incredible, powerful, rich music. I put this sort of above some of the songs I don't like very much, like Welcome to Kanagawa, which I don't really care for. Maybe above some like Four Black Dragons, which is just okay kind of for me. But maybe in the middle. It's not a favorite, but it's not one I sort of go, eh.
Yeah, it's hard. Like, I think it is an effective way to end the show. Mm. But yeah, like, if I was to sit down and just listen to individual songs, this is never going to probably be my first choice from this show. So I'm kind of there with you. Well, Erik, thank you so much for joining me here today. Now, I have not yet announced on the show what the next few months are going to look like, but I will say this is a little treat for people. It's going to be a little bit different until the end of the year. I'm going to try out a few different things. But I will say, like, our next major show we will be covering, of course, is going to be Sweeney Todd. So Erik, any parting thoughts on Sweeney Todd before we go?
It's the show I love less than every other Sondheim fan.
Oh, interesting.
It is obviously a masterpiece. It's just not really for me. It is very much for my co-host on my musical podcast. It is not for me.
Well, that is a good segue here then. If people wanted to stay in contact with you online, what is the easiest ways to do so?
The easiest and by far best way is to find my podcast about musicals, not just Sondheim. That was taken when I decided to do my podcast.
That's right.
it's called, but it is a Sondheim lyric as the title. It's called So Much Stuff to Sing. And it's twice a month, we pick just a song from a musical. We sort of have mini series connected thematically. And yeah, we just talk about sort of a song for about half an hour. And it's really fantastic with my co-host. And it's really great. And our most recent episode as a recording, it was about I Dreamed a Dream from Les Miserables.
Nice, nice.
Yeah.
What's your favorite version of I Dreamed a Dream?
The one where they don't sing it. I don't like the song.
Oh, there you go. Okay.
Yeah, I don't like the song. I think I begin the episode by saying, I don't like this show. I don't like this show. I don't like this show.
I guess you're the miserable one on that episode.
Waka waka. But yeah, and if you'd rather find me on Twitter, you can find me on Twitter at SJC Austenite. That's SJCAUSTENITE.
All right. Thanks, Erik.
Thank you so much, Kyle.
Thanks so much for listening. You can send emails to puttingittogetherpodcast@gmail.com. You can also follow Sondheim Podcast on Twitter and Instagram. And you can support the show on Patreon by going to patreon.com/puttingittogetherpodcast. Thank you to the Alberta Podcast Network and to ATB this week. Putting It Together is available on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, and pretty much anywhere you can get podcasts from. Consider subscribing so that you never miss an episode. Next week, we'll be talking about the cut songs from Pacific Overtures. I guess we'll just have to pray about it. As always, a big thank you to the great Chris Taniguchi, who designed the podcast artwork, and to Nick Driscoll for composing our theme music. Well, we've reached the end of our episode. Yes, I know. Goodbye for now.